Headaches are the number one reason that kids have a neurological problem. And this is the number one reason they go to the pediatrician, they go to the ER, urgent care. And the number one reason they get referred to child neurology or pediatric neurology is headache. And so headaches are something we see in kids of literally all ages. Infants and toddlers can get what we call precursors to migraines. And these are vomiting syndromes or recurrent dizzy spells, things along those lines. They don't get the typical headache with the pain. But once kids get into school age, the most common headaches that we see are the most common headaches we see in adults. And that's tension type headache, which is what we call the stress headache, the everyday headache that people complain about or mention or have. Really that typically falls into a tension type headache, which is really a nondescript, mild to moderate headache that's just sort of there and people recognize. And then there's the more concerning headache that kids get, and especially the adolescents, and that's migraines. And so that's the most disabling, most troublesome headache that pediatric patients, kids of all ages get. And that's most of what we see in our practice and in our headache center. And those are the more moderate to severe headaches with the other symptoms like nausea, vomiting, sensitivity to light and sound. The only other one I would maybe mention as far as a common headache type that we see in pediatrics, we get a lot of post-traumatic headaches. So a lot of kids that have head injuries, concussions, will often get headaches afterwards. And that often overlaps with tension and migraine, but it is slightly different, and we do address that and treat that a little bit different. But those are the most common headaches that we see in kids of all ages. The biggest question I get from parents and from other providers is when do we worry about these headaches? Headaches is something we see all the time. It's the number one reason that they're showing up in pediatricians or primary care offices, to the ER, to urgent care. And when do you worry? When should you do a workup on that child, ultimately, is what you're getting at. And we look for really two things. It's history and it's their exam. And in the history, you look for red flags. So these are things such as overnight headaches or early morning awakenings from headaches, overnight vomiting, early morning vomiting, signs of increased intracranial pressure. You also are looking at things such as an abrupt onset, the worst headache of my life, which that's a tricky one because every time a child comes in with a bad headache, it's the worst headache of their life. So you have to use a little bit of clinical judgment of, is this really that bad or not? And you can tell. Other red flags include other neurological symptoms that might have popped up, whether it be an abrupt change in their mental status, in their grades in school, their behavior, their emotional status, or things such as seizures or movement disorders. These are some of the red flags that we think about. Other things include their physical exam. So specifically on the neurological exam, you look for a fundoscopic exam, looking for signs of intracranial pressure and sort of a optic nerve swelling or papilledema. You look at their reflexes, is there any asymmetry? You look for subtle signs of weakness. So is their pronator drift a little bit off, or is there subtle asymmetry in their strength in their arms or legs? You look at their coordination, and then you look at their gait to really make sure you're not missing anything. And if those areas all look normal, then odds are there's nothing much to worry about, especially if they've had headaches for at least 6 months or longer. It's exceedingly unusual at that point that there'd be anything to worry. So once we've gone through and we figured out kind of what kind of headache your child has and whether or not there's any worry or things that you need to think about, a workup or investigation to make sure you're not missing anything, the next question that gets asked is, well, how do we treat? What do we do to help our kids get better and feel better so they're not having the headaches? And I look at this as a comprehensive approach where it's sort of like building a house. And I use this analogy in my own clinic with my own patients, because any kid, whether they're a toddler with building blocks or Legos, or whether they're a graduate student in engineering or architecture, understands when you build a house, you have to start at the bottom or the foundation. You work your way up with the supporting sort of treatments or supporting structure, and then you put the roof on to end with. We treating headache is the same way. You start at the foundation, and the simple thing is working on lifestyle. It's things we take for granted. It's, are you getting your age-appropriate sleep? And again, that's 10 to 12 hours for elementary school. It's 9 to 10 hours for middle schoolers, 8 to 9 hours for high schoolers, and 8 hours for college and graduate students. Most of the kids aren't getting that because they're too busy. Their lives are too hectic. But that's the recommendation. Are they hydrating? they drinking enough fluids? And I ask, how much do they pee during the day? It's a weird question. People don't keep track of it. But if you're peeing every 2 or 3 hours, you know you're hydrating, assuming you're not drinking too much caffeine or other things that would cause you to go to the bathroom more. Diet is another thing that we think about, and it's, are you eating breakfast, lunch, and dinner? Are you consistent? Are you keeping a stable metabolism, keeping that energy level up for the brain? Are you overdoing the caffeine? So too much caffeine can cause headaches, and especially migraines, and be a problem. So especially for the adolescents, are they doing too much coffee or energy drinks? That's an easy thing to work on. Exercise is one of the best treatments, and also one of the biggest causes that's modifiable or preventable for pediatric headache. So keeping these kids active cardiovascularly is important. So we recommend 20 to 30 minutes at least 3 to 4 times a week of hot, sweaty, out of breath, really, really doing something. And then the final sort of conservative approach is working on day-to-day stress and anxiety. And all these kids have stress and anxiety. That's part of life. But if it's really adding to their daily routine, if it's contributing to the headaches, if it's a lot on them, then it's taking a step back, recognizing that, and trying to find a way to treat that. The second part of treatment that falls under sort of the conservative non-medicine approach, if you will, is using complementary alternative therapies. And there's a lot of evidence for this in pediatric headache as well as adult headache. More evidence is in the adult world, but even in the pediatric population, we've seen studies that show that behavioral therapy, pain therapy, biofeedback, physical therapy, acupuncture, all of these have really good evidence. And so we use these at our discretion if the kids buy in. The kids have to be interested in these. Making a kid go to see a therapist if they're not going to talk to them and it's just going to be a fight, it's going to make things worse, not better. So we offer all of these to our patients, just like you can, and you find the one that works for the kids. They're all great. They're all good options. None of them are perfect. When you're going through the treatment sort of algorithm, if you will, or the treatment sort of pathway, again, you're starting with that foundation, the lifestyle changes, you're doing your supportive therapies, your complementary alternative therapies. And then if that's not getting you where you need, or if maybe that's not something that interests your patients or your families, we have daily preventative options, and we have acute treatment options as well that fall under sort of the medicines and nutraceuticals. So when you talk about daily prevention, there is maybe 15 to 20 different treatments that are available out there. Some of them have been tested and studied in kids. Most have been studied in adults, and we sort of extrapolate down to the pediatric population. What I will say is that there was a study, the largest NIH-funded pediatric headache study done maybe a handful of years ago, that looked at comparing the top two, what we thought were the top two medications for pediatric patients, to placebo. And what they found was is that they all work, even placebo. And you could take that on the surface and say, well, that means nothing works. Well, that's not true. It means everything works. It means all of these are good options. And the most important part about thinking about medicines, it's not so much what you pick, it's that you get your patients to buy into it, that you get them to believe that this is something that's going to help them, and that you listen to their story and believe that they need treatment for their headaches. And if they take that treatment that you provide, no matter what it is, because everything has been shown to be helpful, odds are you're going to get some benefit. And if not, we go to the next step. When you really tease it out, we have allergy medicines like cyproheptadine or periactin. We have blood pressure medicines, beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, and ARBs, so angiotensin blockers. We have antidepressants or anxiety meds that we use, so tricyclic antidepressants or SNRIs, things like, you know, venlafaxine or duloxetine. And then there's even a new treatment category that are CGRP related, and that's a specific chemical that actually is in part of the migraine pathway that has finally been targeted with some of these new treatment options. Unfortunately, these have not been studied in pediatric patients, so they're only approved in adults, and right now most of us are not using those in the pediatric populations, although it's going to start happening over the next months to years in the older adolescents and then trickle down. You also have nutraceutical options. So this is where some families don't want medicines, and that's fine. We know that several of the vitamins and supplements can be really helpful to prevent headaches. And this would include magnesium, vitamin B2 or riboflavin, coenzyme Q10, and melatonin. There's others out there as well, but those seem to have the best evidence and the best benefit for our patients, and those are the ones that we typically use. Even if you have a good preventative plan in place with your lifestyle changes, your complementary therapies, and even a daily preventative, whether it be medicine or vitamin supplements, what happens when that kid gets a really bad headache or a bad migraine and they're in the midst of it, and how do we make that stop? And so that's where we talk about acute treatment options. Within the acute treatment options, again, there's a variety of options that we have, including medications, but there's even some non-medicine options, procedure or technology-based treatments that are also available. From a medication standpoint, combination tends to work best. We start simple, so it's an age and weight-based dosing for either ibuprofen or acetaminophen. The younger kids in the studies, both were equally effective. And the teenagers and adults, the NSAIDs, the ibuprofen category, the naproxen category, tend to work better. So it's that with hydration. So with a bottle of water, Gatorade juice, I don't care, something non-caffeinated, just to give them more fluids. If it's actually a migraine, then we can add from there caffeine, which sometimes has help in small amounts once in a while. Daily caffeine can make things worse, big picture, but small amounts at the onset of a migraine can be really helpful. And we can also add antiemetics in, especially the anti-dopaminergic agents such as Compazine or Reglan. Compazine tends to have better evidence in the pediatric population. Reglan is used more commonly in the adult population. Both are good. We can also add in migraine-specific medicines with the triptans. So that's a category of medicines that work just for migraine, as well as other headaches like cluster headaches, although we don't see too much of that in the pediatric population. And there's 7 or 8 of these that it's trial and error. You try one, and if it works, great, and if it doesn't, you kind of go down the line until you find one that does work for your patient. But this is the combination that can be used acutely when it's onset of a migraine. If that doesn't work, there are procedure-based options that we have, such as nerve blocks. There's always infusion centers. There's ER protocols and inpatient IV protocols that can be done for patients if they're really stuck in a bad headache. And there's even a new nerve stimulating device called Cephaly that's been around for a few years that can be used as an acute option as well that we use in our clinic. We're sort of in a new era of pediatric headache, and the fact that in the last handful of years there's been several new options that have hit the market and been looked at for both acute and preventative standpoints. Now, some of these have been looked at in pediatrics on the surface. Most of these have been studied in adults, as most sort of big studies go with new treatments, whether they're medicines, devices, technologies. They tend to start with the adults and then from there move into the pediatric population. From a medication standpoint, the newest option, the sort of biggest option out there, and it's everywhere on the news and in the reports, it's the CGRP antibody treatments. And this is a new category of medicine designed specifically to go after the migraine pathway, to go after actually what's happening during a migraine to stop that and to prevent that from happening. And these are injectable options and or an IV option. There are 3 that are now on the market that have been out for the first time. One was out in May, and then 2 more have come out this fall in September, October. And these are auto-injectors or injections that have to be given about once a month that work as an immune-modulating treatment to target either the antibody, the antibody itself, the CGRP molecule peptide itself, or the receptor where these bind. Both have good evidence in adults, and we're just getting into the pediatric study stages now. So right now, they're not being used widespread in pediatrics, but with these new studies that are developing and coming out, this will be the hope in the near future that we'll have new treatment options to offer these patients. From a technology side, Cephaly, which is a nerve-stimulating device designed to target the trigeminal nerve in the forehead. You wear it right here, you put a little patch on, it connects by magnet, and it works as a direct nerve stimulator for that trigeminal nerve, which we know is the nerve involved in many headaches, including migraine. And so it's got both a preventative setting that you wear daily to substitute for a daily preventative medication or supplement, and it's also got an acute setting that, again, you could substitute instead of the medications you're using, you could use this instead. And so we have this to have our patients try, and if they find it helpful or if they like it or can tolerate it, it's a great option for those patients that we can do. I think the biggest reason is that we have a team approach from the beginning that we have access to every discipline and every option that could be used for the treatment of headache. In our clinic alone, I have a team with a dedicated nurse practitioner and physician assistant that the three of us do nothing but headache medicine. We also have a dedicated behavioral psychologist that is part of our clinics at various locations. We serve here at the Children's Center and through the outpatient center here at Hopkins. We also have an office where we all serve patients at Bayview. We do outreach clinics up at Green Spring Station, and then we also have an outreach clinic down in Annapolis. It's through AAMC, but it's actually a Hopkins-based clinic. It's just housed at Anne Arundel Medical Center. And I think that we offer that multidisciplinary approach that not everywhere can, and we're fortunate to have that, but that's how you get these kids better, is you look at them as a whole person, treat them all around, rather than just giving them a medication or a treatment, because that's unfortunately all that some places can do because of the limited resources.
Thank you.